morning. I am Professor Dr. A. Michael Maran, HOD of Madras Medical College, Chennai, and the Director, Institute of Thoracic Medicine. Today, we are going to take a topic on the management of extra pulmonary TB. So, all of us know, even at the time of diagnosis, right, TB diagnosis is a very complicated one in extra pulmonary TB, because we can't confirm all cases as microbiologically confirmed case. So, to diagnose a TB case, we have to first try to, as far as possible, to confirm it microbiologically by smear, culture or a rapid molecular test, okay. Then we have to try to do a clinically diagnosed TB, which is mostly the commonest in extra pulmonary TB. Once you know it's a TB case, we have to know whether it is a patient who has already taken a treatment, or it's a new case, or it is a drug resistant TB. Normally, history of TB is the way where we find out whether it's a new case or a previously treated or a patient who has come from somewhere with the already diagnosed TB. Once you know it's a previously treated case, we should know whether it is a recurrence of the TB, that's what we call it as a relapse, or it is a treatment after last follow-up. Most of the cases would have taken treatment for more than 1 month and then come to you later defaulting the therapy and coming to you. So, then it is a case of last follow-up. Similarly, there might be some patients who are on a treatment failure, because most of the TB cases, they have to have good responses within 2 to 3 months. Let us say even after 5 months of TB therapy, there is no good clinical or any microbiologically confirmed response, then we call it as a treatment after failure. And on day one itself, nowadays with good molecular technologies, or we can even diagnose drug resistance very quickly, like mono drug resistant, poly drug resistant, or just RIF resistance alone, or MDR-TB or XDR. MDR, all of them you would have already been told about that. So, once you know that you have a confirmed case of extra pulmonary TB, management is the most important thing in extra pulmonary TB. So, it's not very different from other patients, okay. So, in what are the challenges which we will face? The treatment regimen is the same, but the duration of therapy is a little different. Then monitoring of a patient who is taking treatment is very important, because we have to know whether he has a good response to the therapy or not, because we still don't have all patients confirmed to be microbiologically positive and still being monitoring them. The most next important thing is the role of steroids. So, in pulmonary TB, we don't have much role of steroids, but in extra pulmonary TB, we have some patients who will do well for steroid therapy. Then the fifth important thing is surgery. So, most of the patients who the extra pulmonary TB might develop during the therapy itself some complications, or because of as a sequelae, they might need surgical management. And the most important thing is paradoxical reaction. So, let us look at all these problems in our patients. So, the first and most important thing is the therapy. Like in extra pulmonary TB, all new TB patients have to have a 6 months therapy with isoniazid, rifamycin, ethambutol and pyrazinamide daily for the first 2 months, followed by 4 months of isoniazid, rifamycin and ethambutol. Why we have added ethambutol is because there is a high level of primary drug resistance even to INH in our country. So, we don't want to have acquired drug resistance to rifamycin. Then for previously treated patients, the regimen is for 8 month course with SM for the first 2 months and all the other four drugs, followed by 5 months of INS, rifamycin and ethambutol. So, this is a common regimen which we all follow. So, depending upon the we have to have a proper dosage as far as the daily regimens are concerned. It's not like in those days when we were giving intermittent therapy. So for INH it is 5 milligram, for rifampicin is 10 milligram, and ethambutol it is 15 milligram, streptomycin it is 15 milligram, and pyrazinamide it is 25 milligram. So at the most in INH and rifampicin, you have to have it as only 300 milligram the maximum dose, and in for rifampicin 600 milligram, whatever the weight is. Let us say a patient is 70 kg, even you can't give 700 milligram of rifampicin, you have to give him 600 milligram of rifampicin, right? And some of these things you can even have a substitution. So most of the patients which we are now treating in the national program RNTCP, we have typical fixed dose drug combination. We call it as FDC, that is fixed drug combinations, which comes as tablets for 15 kg body weight patients. So each tablet is equivalent to 15 kg body weight patient. So all patients who are in the 25 to 29, you will get 2 tablets. Once they are 30 to 45, it will be 3 tablets. Once they are more than 50 to 60, it is will be 4 tablets, and after 70, it will be 5 tablets. You can modify the dose of streptomycin in elderly, because more than 50 years, the chance of them developing ototoxicity and vestibular problem is very high. So you have to reduce the dose in most of your adult population by at least by 250 milligram dose. So the next important thing, as I told you, most of your pulmonary TB, you give the duration of therapy only for 6 months. But for extra pulmonary, when there is a group of patients who are, we call it as seriously ill extra pulmonary TB, the duration of therapy is a little higher. But for all cases, especially lymph node TB, abdominal TB, pericardial TB, and urogenital TB, female genital tract TB, and cutaneous TB, where the basilary load is very less, the duration of therapy is for only 6 months. But for patients who have severe forms of TB, like ocular TB, spinal TB, spinal TB with neurological dysfunction, CNS tuberculomas, and TB meningitis, and ENT TB, the duration of therapy is a little higher. Especially for spinal and those with bone and joint involvement, it will be for 1 year to 1.5 years. So for all extra pulmonary TB, depending upon the clinical response, you can increase the duration of the continuation phase. That is the phase where we give just INH, rifampicin, ethambutol for 3 months to 6 months, depending upon the clinical response. So what are the indications for surgery in extra pulmonary TB? All of you know that patients with retinitis or vitreous involvement will have some loss of vision. So sometimes you might have to do some surgical procedures as vitrectomy, or let us say as a retinal detachment, we have to do some laser surgery. Similarly, in meningitis, it is very common for some of the children especially to develop hydrocephalus. So it can happen as a sequelae to TB meningitis, or even during the inflammatory process. So to prevent that, sometimes we use steroids, and surgery is a very common indication for reducing the hydrocephalus by doing a shunting. We do a shunting always for most of your hydrocephalus. Then TB pericarditis. TB pericarditis can sometimes lead on to constrictive pericarditis and even cardiac tamponade. So once they develop that, you need to do a surgery, or sometimes to relieve, you need to remove the fluid. The next commonest indication is abdominal TB, where most of them with the abdominal TB will develop a stricture, or sometimes they can even cocoon. That is, the whole inflammatory process can make the intestine into a cocoon and produce a subacute obstruction of the intestine, where you need to do surgery for all your patients. urogenital TB, the commonest problem is obstructure, or you sometimes you can have obstruction also. So nowadays we have catheter based therapy like percutaneous nephrostomy, we have stenting and all those things which can be as a useful option. In female urogenital TB, most of them will have tube ovarian masses. Once even after therapy, the tube ovarian mass size will not reduce. So such patients will have a better option of removal of the TB ovarian mass for better outcomes. And the most important thing is spinal TB, where surgical management has a major role, especially let us say a patient with spinal TB later develops severe spinal deformity, even corrective surgeries can happen. And the most important thing is when he is in a TB disease, if the patient develops a spinal paraparesis, the most important thing is even before he develops it, you have to intervene and stabilize his spinal column to prevent the obstruction to the spinal cord to make him a persistent paraparetic. And the other most less common thing is sometimes when you have a very large paraspinal abscess, you have to drain it surgically. Then what is the role of steroids in extrapulmonary TB? So why do you use steroids and why we are very afraid of using steroids? There are some conditions where extrapulmonary TB, we have adverse outcome, right, for the neurological disabilities, especially in spinal tuberculosis, the patient can have a compression of his spinal cord by a abscess, or because of a fracture of the spine, you can have an compression of the spine, or you can have even anterior spinal artery being obstructed by a vasculitis. So all these things are a problem for a patient to develop paraspinal problems and leading to paraparesis of his lower limbs. So it's very important that we intervene in such patients and try to decompress the lesion so that he will not develop a paraparesis. Then there is a lot of problems of sequelae like fibrosis. So it happens in the intestines. Okay. So some of them who have TB abdomen with a TB ulcer will develop a stricture leading on to subacute obstruction of his abdomen. Similarly, patients who have pericardial effusion, TB pericardial, can lead on to constrictive pericarditis, and some of the patients who have urogenital TB, especially urological TB, will develop strictures and you can have a problem. So steroids can avert some of the about outcomes. So the dosage of steroids is 1 milligram per kg body weight for the first 4 weeks, then slowly taper it off within the next 4 weeks. That is, therapy will be at the most for 2 months. So what are the disadvantages of giving a steroid, and why we are more apprehensive of using a steroids is the suppression of the immune system. A patient with tuberculosis, especially extrapulmonary TBs and severe forms of TB, are already immunosuppressed. So steroids can do a lot of immunosuppression, that's why we are very apprehensive of using a steroid. So then there is because of that there is an increased risk of infection. So some of them can develop over long term the complications like hyperglycemia, hypertension. Most of them will have some GI symptoms or GI bleed and electrolyte imbalance, which will happen very early during the treatment of steroids. So the most important thing, and which is being approved throughout the world, is corticosteroids in TB meningitis. Because why we use it is because we don't want the patient to develop a sequelae because of the TB meningitis. So steroids help in reducing the inflammation in the subarachnoid space, so preventing them to develop a hydrocephalus. Similarly, they reduce the cerebral or spinal edema and intracranial pressure, so you don't develop a hydrocephalus. Similarly, they also reduce the inflammation in the arthritis, So most of the TB patients will have some type of arthritis because of an immune mediated response. So those arthritis can be reduced so that the brain supply or the spinal supply will be maintained. So what are the commonest indication which we use steroids? The most important thing is TB meningitis. It is recommended for all, even HIV positives or HIV negatives. But let us say HIV positive has a severe extra OI, maybe we have to consider whether to give steroids. But most of the HIV patients with TB meningitis should be given steroids to prevent the hydrocephalus to form. The next important thing is TB pericarditis, where you have a recommendation. So not all your patients with TB pericarditis need to have, but it's recommended when you feel that he is going, might go in for a constrictive pericarditis. Then ocular TB, it's always recommended because most of them, if they have an inflammation and they develop a sequelae like retinal detachment or vitreous lesions, fibrosis and all those things, if they are eye vision can be a problem. So it's very important that we recommend steroids in all our ocular TB. And all of you know Addison's disease, where there is a hypoaldosteronism, where all of you know that you need steroids as a therapy. So the indications for pleural effusion TB is not there. So in those days, most of them with the TB pleural effusion were given steroids. So you don't give steroids for all your TB pleural effusions now. So you should be very careful when you give steroids for your TB pleural effusion. Similarly, you should not give for ENT, which is not recommended. Thank you.